Hello, everyone, and welcome to another Motorsport Magazine podcast. And this time, it's in association with Mercedes-Benz, which is great news, and I'll tell you more about it in a second. We've got a few other firsts today, one of which you'll probably see if you're watching the video. We are doing our first Al Fresco podcast. And you might think we're in the south of France, but actually this is England. It's incredible weather, and hopefully we'll get to the end without expiring from the heat. So, other news, it's our 100th podcast. So since 2009, we've recorded 6,000 minutes of audio. And someone a lot more clever than me in the office managed to work out that you could listen to them back to back, non-stop, on your way to Australia and back twice, which... it's not a very useful statistic, but interesting nonetheless. So we've had some amazing guests in our time, and I'm going to just read out a couple of their achievements, because it's absolutely incredible. They've managed 10 IndyCar or kart championships, 12 world championships in Formula One, 23 Isle of Man TT wins, and that's all down to John McGuinness, 38 Le Mans wins, 38 motorcycle world championship wins, and 204 Grand Prix wins, which is an amazing stat. So to today, and the Mercedes partnership. They've secured the future of these podcasts, which is really, really exciting news. And they're going to be with us for the next year, and hopefully we can do some amazing stuff over that time. So, the 100th podcast, a very warm welcome to Derek Warwick.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
I think what we're going to do today is rewind all the way back to the beginning and start talking about how you got into the sport, because it wasn't your average route into single-seater racing, was it?
No, not really. My father and uncle have raced all their life, karts, short ovals, etc., etc. So it's in the blood. You know, we come from agricultural trailer business, so there was always... cranes and drots and forklifts, and we had a big field beside about 5 acres where I used to have this old car, and I used to go round and round and round and learn to balance it on two wheels and all sorts of things. So it was always in the blood. I did karting when I was 12, just for 1 year. Won the Southern Area Championship. Ran out of money, and then my father and uncle started the short oval racing, Formula 2 Superstocks. I started when I was 15, put my age on a year, and started in stock cars, and then the second year moved up to Superstock. So Superstocks are sort of like a sprint car, oval racing, sort of a semi-contact formula, but very tricky, obviously only two corners, so it was quite difficult to get the maximum out of the car. So I think I learned very quickly the mechanical side of racing, and it was something that carried me, I think, through all my career, is I understood how the car worked, I understood how it felt, and I could transfer that to the engineer and team.
And am I right, your father raced against you a lot of the time, and I'd read somewhere that I think he fought a few of the fights post-race for you as you stayed in the car when you were a young lad?
Well, it's quite funny really, because when I was 16, 17, I was still only about 4 foot nothing, and obviously not big enough to fight my own battles. So my father and uncle, who were a couple of tough guys really, I used to cause havoc out on the circuit because I was quick, and I didn't care who I upset. So when I came in, having caused havoc, my father always told me to keep myself strapped in the car, visor down, and then I would see these guys rolling over my bonnet, punching, everybody was having a big fight, and then gradually it all settled down, and I'd get out the car, work on my car, and go out into the next race. So it was good times racing as my father and uncle. But it was then really, when I look back, that I realized the selfishness that I had, because although I raced my father and uncle, we would obviously change engines quite often. And we'd go to a circuit, and all of a sudden my father or my uncle's engine was quicker than mine. How can this be? We come back that night from the racetrack, and me and my mechanics would work all night, take his engine out, put it in my car, take my engine out, and put it back in his car. So he knew about it. I wasn't lying or anything. But I realized then that I wanted to win, you know, and I wanted to win almost at all costs, really.
But at that time, you wanted to win the English Championship and then the World Championship in Superstocks. You didn't have any dreams about being a Formula One driver at that time, did you?
A million miles away. I'm not even sure I knew that it was there, to be honest. You know, my life was cut out by my father. I would race Superstocks. I'd become world champion. I'd take over the family business. I'd run the family business, and that was it. You know, and trying to persuade my father to go to the next step, financially as much as anything, was a big job. And it was something that me and my Uncle Stan, I've got to talk about my Uncle Stan at this point, because he was a nutter. He really was. He was definitely not all there. He flew helicopters. He won the King's Cup air race in 73. He flew under the Tower Bridge and got banned for 6 months. He was really a wild card. So I had these two fathers. My Uncle Stan had five daughters. So I was the sort of surrogate son, if you like. And then obviously I had my father. My uncle was this nutter that would always push me that next step. And my father was this conservative, typical father that only thought about his son and was worried about his son. So I had these two wonderful influences coming together.
Amazing. And then by 17, you were English champion. And then by 19, you were world champion. I was digging through the motorsport archive yesterday, actually, and came across a piece that you did, I think with Alan Henry, about your greatest race. And you voted the championship decider when you became world champion of Superstocks as your greatest race over Le Mans, the Formula One races. Why was that race? I mean, obviously, it was special because you won the championship and things. But why was the greatest?
I think because all my family was there. My father was in the race. My uncle hadn't qualified. He probably got drunk or something. I can't remember.
He's probably busy flying under Tower Bridge.
Exactly. Yeah. But I think basically it was because it was my ambition. You know, from when I was a 10-year-old, I wanted to race short ovals, I wanted to be world champion, I wanted to race against my father and uncle, and at that time, I didn't know about Formula One. It was, you know, I saw a little bit on television, but very little. The coverage was pretty poor back in those days. So I only wanted to be world champion, and that night was just the most amazing night of my life. Wimbledon at capacity crowd, great racing. I lapped my father, and the last sort of 10 laps
of... You had a better engine than him. I used
his engine. And he pulled off with 10 laps to go because he was looking at the scoreboard and seeing I was still leading. And he got too nervous to be in the same race, so he pulled off. And the emotion afterwards was just enormous. Of course, when I won Le Mans, it was equally as big, but it's more professional. You know, we were amateur boy racers, and you know, we built the car ourselves, we built the engine ourselves. It kind of was it was a bigger thing in some ways, you know.
And you did obviously go into circuit racing. Having won that world championship, how did you go from that to single seaters? Because as you said, you weren't really that aware of Formula One.
I wasn't aware of Formula Ford. No, I mean, I was aware of nothing. You know, it just my mad uncle was flying his plane out of Thruxton Aerodrome, and at the end of '74, he was watching Jeff Lees win Formula Ford races. And he went into the pits and saw these amazing Formula Fords with independent suspension and Hewlin gearboxes. He came back to our little town in Horsford and said, look, there's a racing car show at the end of 74. We will go up and, you know, look at this Formula Ford stuff and see if we fancy doing it. father didn't want nothing to do with it. He said, absolutely not, wouldn't come to it. So my two mechanics, my Uncle Stan and I went up there, got introduced to Hawk, to David Lazenby, and we were completely blown away by the technology compared to a stock car. It was pretty awesome, to be honest. And we just wanted to do it. So we put a budget together, because you didn't go back to my father without some sort of budget. And we lied through our hind teeth how much it was going to cost, and just so as to get Dad up the next day. And eventually we persuaded him, and he came up, because we knew once we got him through the door and got him to look at the cars, he'd be sold. And that's where we went Formula Ford racing. We still, the deal was, it was quite simple. We go Formula Ford racing. I'd work from 7 to 6 every day in Warwick Trailers, the family business. You were not allowed to work at all on the race car during working hours. You could only work on the car in the evenings and the weekends, and race at weekends, obviously. And that was the deal, and that's what we did. So we ran it out the workshop from Warwick Trailers, in a corner of the workshop with people making, welding agricultural trailers next to me almost. And that's how we went racing. We really learned the hard way. The two mechanics I had were just two friends. One was a diesel mechanic and the other was a chippy. And they didn't, even the 2 years we raced Formula Ford in 75 and 76, and the 2 years we ran Formula 3 in 77 and 78, they couldn't even change the gear ratios. I was still the only guy that could in the team that could change gear ratios. So to come away with, in 76, 33 Formula Ford wins, and then in 78 racing against the might of Piquet and Sierra and De Chesres, and winning the Van der Velde Championship, was a pretty mean feat, to be honest.
Can I just rewind from the Van der Velde title? My Alton Park was my local circuit, but in 1975, early 75, I was staying with relatives down in Kent, and I went to Lyddon Hill. It was the first time I'd ever heard of you, and I found the programme. This is not going to work for people who aren't watching the video, but it's not a gift I'm keeping this, but I'm going to scan it for you. But if you look in there, April the 6th, 1975, Lyddon Circuit Motor Racing, according to my scrawled notes, you're on pole for the first Formula Ford heat, but you got beaten, and you didn't feature in the top three in the final. I don't know if you remember Lyddon Hill, April 75.
Well, am I allowed to swear on this podcast?
Yeah, you asked that last time as well, actually.
Did I? Well, the Hawk DL12 was a shitbox, to be honest, and anybody that can put that on pole was a pretty good driver, that's all I can say. But you know, this was the start of Formula Ford. You know, I had a gearbox. I had to change gear. I mean, in oval racing, you know, you keep the thing stuck in fourth gear, and that's where you are for the whole race. You know, so we had to learn how to brake and clutch and downchange and change gear. I mean, it was. But obviously, there was something there. You know, anybody that can put Hawk DL12 on pole must be pretty good, I tell you.
But I mean, did you find that the racecraft, I mean, a lot of people say that one of the best universities for learning car control and racecraft, short ovals.
Yeah.
Because you're in traffic the whole flipping time.
Yeah.
I mean, did you find that the transition, because of what you'd done in short ovals, the transition to, because the Formula Ford in the mid-70s, quite often 2 heats, sometimes 3 heats in a final, or 80-odd cars entered, it was ferocious. Did you find that just, it came naturally?
Absolutely. And I think in 76, again, you know, we didn't have big budgets. I think I only crashed once, you know, out of 60 odd races, you know, winning 33, I only crashed once. And as you well know, you know, 76 was the height of Formula Ford.
It was a fantastic season.
Derek Daly, Devaney, Bremner.
David Kennedy.
David Kennedy, Walsh, all these guys were just incredible. Rick Morris was just incredible racing.
Rick's still racing Formula Ford now.
Who's still racing Formula Ford now, yeah. So, yeah, I think it helped me. I think the only thing that went against me is if something happened or I took somebody off or whatever, then it was the dirty stock car driver. You know, when I won great races, it was a great racecraft from oval racing. So you carried that stock car banner for quite a bit, really through the first parts of Formula Ford, and you lost it in Formula 3 because all of a sudden people looked at you different when you got into Formula 3 because you were that one step from Formula 1.
By this, in Formula Ford, were you by now thinking, right, Formula 1 is where I want to be? Was that as soon as you had tasted Formula Ford? Was that how quick it was, or did that
No, I mean, I started watching Formula One because obviously 76 when I won my championships, of course the great James Hunt won his world championship. And also we had the Formula 5000s were sometimes the backup race. We were the backup race of Formula 5000.
Interesting way of looking at it.
I got lost there a little bit, yeah. yeah. And you saw people like Teddy Pellett, Alan Jones in the Thursday's car, and you saw these great big thundering 5000s coming through Russell at Snett and places like that. And I used to just think, wow, wouldn't that be something special? So that was the nearest I was really to Formula One. I don't think I really realised I was good enough or a possibility to get to Formula One until my second year of Formula 3. You know, when we won the first five races and people really sat up and started looking at Derek Warwick, and knowing also that it was still being run off the back of a trailer in a workshop with Warwick trailers. So I think then I started to think, you know what, maybe I'm good enough, because you just didn't know, because it wasn't our upbringing, you know.
I think it's probably a good point to bring this, actually. Just something else I found in my archive. It's a picture I took in the Alton Park paddock in 1978.
Try not to imagine how much junk Simon has in his archive.
I was taking a picture of Doug Niven's Beetle, but in the background there, again, this isn't going to work particularly well on the podcast.
You'll see a photo on the video.
A knackered old bus with Warwick Trailers, British International Formula. That is a championship-winning team operating. Can you reconcile that
a knackered old bus.
It's a lovely
I was wondering whether he was going to get away with that.
It's a lovely knackered old bus.
We spent 6 months building that knackered old bus, and it was our pride and joy, because we'd put the car in the back and we'd sleep in the front. Yeah. And we went to Monaco sleeping in the front of the bus and preparing the car out the back. That knackered old bus was the pride and joy of Warwick Trailers, let me tell you. No, it was great to be able to go racing and keep the community together, keep all my mechanics and everybody together. And at that time, obviously, I'd met my wife, and I'd met my wife actually in when I was doing oval racing. So she was she came all the way through all that. So it was great racing. You know, what I realise now with hindsight. That how we won those races in Formula 3, how we had the success we had, I have no idea. When you're racing against Nelson Piquet in the might of Rout, because Rout was really behind Piquet, you know, he was getting live engines from Pedrazzani, the Nova Motors, and I had this one engine that I just used to cherish day after day after day. It goes to show that, you know, we were competing well above where we should be, that's for sure.
I read somewhere, I think it was with the lunch with Simon Taylor you did, that the F3, the step up to F3 wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for a phone call asking for a ridiculous number of trailers that you didn't actually have space or time to build.
In the end of 76, we were flat out in the trailer business. And I was trying to convince my father to go Formula 3. We were looking at the Chevron B38. Again, my mad uncle and I got together and we put this budget together that Formula 3 was going to cost us £10,000. And we went to my dad with this budget and said, this is what it's going to cost us. We had a bit of money from BP and a few private individuals. And then our salesman came to us and said, we just had an inquiry from Saudi Arabia for 6 bow trailers. And these just flatbed long trailers, what we call, we used to put bows of straw. And I remember my dad saying, absolutely no way, we can't fit no more in. We're working every hour God sends. You know, we just can't do no more. And I remember Pete Rawlins, our salesman, saying, well, I've got to go back and tell him something. And he said, well, quote 3 times the price. So I remember the number. It was 6. We had to do 6 trailers, and it was £6,000 a trailer. And we were knocking them out for 500 quid or something. I mean, it was ridiculous. And so we went back and quoted these 6 trailers, 6 grand a piece, and they said yes. Well, they come back to us, and on the back of that one order, and Dad, Stan, myself, and my two mechanics worked nights to build those six trailers. We never used the normal hours, so we could actually say that the profit from those cars actually ran the F3 cars. And it was just that order that took us to Formula 3.
Looking back at that photograph and nice grassy Alton Park paddock and people operating out of old motor coaches as you were, I mean, can you reconcile that with what we have nowadays with 15-year-olds with managers, agents, fitness trainers, psychologists, etc.?
No, but, you know, that's the 21st century. That's the world we live in, you know. I think being chairman of the McLaren Autosport BIDC Young Driver of the Year, I've realised this last 3 or 4 years how prepared they are mentally, physically. These young, not 15-year-olds, because I won't take a 15-year-old, but they're 16, 17, 18-year-olds. They come to us for this competition. They are ready. They go out in that F2 car. I've never, ever driven it. And their first lap as they come into Stowe, you think, wow, you're just knocked away. Because there's so many other ways now that they can become great drivers. Simulators, they're more attuned to what's going on. So would they have survived in my day? No. Would we have survived in this day? Yes. I always say that somebody always tries to compare Rocky Marciano with Muhammad Ali or Joe Frazier, the same as they do with Fangio, with Moss, with Piquet, with Prost, with Senna. Different eras, but great drivers, great champions, great fighters, great golfers, great sportsmen are great in any era. And if they had been born 10 years later or 20 years later, I still believe that they would have been great racing drivers. So, yes, I think it's just different. And I think the fact that I'm president of the British Racing Drivers Club, the fact that I do the FIA driver steward, it keeps me current. You know, I know what's going on out there, and I appreciate it. And it really is quite humbling when you see these young guys come through.
Something I was going to talk about the British Racing Drivers Club in a bit, but we're very lucky to get you today because you're not only obviously doing that, which is all on your spare time and everything like that, but you've got so many other business interests as well, haven't you? Are you still involved in 888 at all? Yeah,
not UK,
but in Australia.
In Australia, my partner was over last week. Funny enough, we employ 49 people down there. We've got a budget this year of 13 million.
You wouldn't have minded that when you were racing.
No,
would you?
No.
Was that from building trailers overnight?
No, we don't make those many trailers anymore. So, you know, Australia's good, you know, and I've got a good guy running it down there. You know, I employ nearly 200 people. You know, I've got three building companies in the UK. I've got the Honda garage in Jersey. I'm president of the British Racing Drivers Club. I sit on the board. I also, since Paul's accident 25 years ago, I've been on the safety committee of the MSA, and I'm still on the safety committee of the MSA 24 years later. So I am busy. I've been at McLaren this morning. I'm at Silverstone all day tomorrow for a board meeting. I suppose you could say that I'm busier now than any time in my life. You know, I actually, when I go to races now, I look at these racing drivers and I think, you have no idea how lucky you are, how simple your life is, you know, just trying to find another half a tenth through turn six. That I'm quite jealous of them sometimes.
And they don't even have to go and nick their dad's engine either,
no,
do they?
No. Well, they haven't got a mad uncle to compete with.
You mentioned Paul there, and it is obviously the 25th anniversary. We've actually had a couple of questions in, both really about your memories of him, and there's actually quite a nice one here from Alex, who I remember feeling sure that he was a future of British motor racing, blisteringly fast, brave, and as I discovered after I nearly inadvertently planted him in the barriers at the bottom of paddock during a test session of Brands Hatch, utterly charming and gracious in the pits during my gibbering apology.
Oh, that's lovely.
Yeah, which
that's
is a really,
lovely.
Really nice memory.
That's really nice, yeah.
And it's one from Henry Hope Frost asking to the same thing about your memories of him.
I was lucky. Paul came by in our family 14 years after I was born, so he was definitely the baby of the family. So he was spoiled. He was the most spoiled, unspoiled child you could ever meet. He really understood what he wanted. And funny enough, I had a conversation with somebody a couple of days ago when we were talking about tomorrow being his 25th anniversary of his death. When he was in the lower formulas, he was pretty rubbish, to be honest. You know, when he started off in mini stocks, he was rubbish. Then he got into Formula 2, he was stunning. In Formula 2, you know, with the bigger engines and the fast cars that I drove in them days, he was stunning, absolutely unbelievable. He got into Formula Ford, was okay. Formula 3 was a bit difficult for him, but never really in the right team, but always quicker than his teammates, so it sort of showed that he had something there. And then, of course, in 91, he got into 3000, and, well, you know, his record speaks for itself. I think it's 5 pole positions, 4 lap records, 5 wins, including obviously the race that he was killed in, because it passed 75%, so he was still given the full win. So he was a special lad. He was a boy until 91, funny enough. We used to go training for 2 weeks in St Moritz, cross-country skiing, running up mountains, tennis, squash, and go running most nights, all that sort of stuff. And he developed from 91. You know, in 90 he was still following Derek. He was still trying to keep up with me in the gym. He was trying to keep up with me on cross-country skis. He couldn't run up the mountain as quick as I could. In 91, it just like he turned into a man, you know, and I was following him. I was racing him. He was beating me. And another thing he did is, because he was following my career and he sort of hero worshipped me for all the way through, he was clever enough to understand my good points and build on the bad points. So he was more complete racing driver in that 91 season than anybody could have wished for. He was special in our family because he was the baby. I've got 3 sisters, and because he was the baby of the family, everybody just worshipped the ground he walked on. And he was very special. And the day that he had the accident at Oldham Park, it was a big knife in our family. My mother never really got over it. And if you go, this is my daughter's house. If you go around some of her rooms, prominent pictures will be of Paul. In my house would be Paul. My grandchildren know about Paul. Everybody knows about Paul. Not that it's obsessive. Whenever I meet and take my sisters to dinner, the conversation is always about Paul, you know, and this is 25 years later. That's the kind of mark that he's left with us.
It's great that he's remembered so fondly.
Yeah.
and remembered so often as well.
Yeah.
Simon, you must have seen him race quite a lot.
Yes, I did. I mean, I first met him when he was doing the Dunlop Autosport Formula Ford Champ. Well, he did both junior Formula Ford Championships, didn't he, in 87?
Yes.
And I think he won both of them, didn't he?
I think he did, yeah.
Yeah, I saw him racing Formula Ford, Ford 2000, Formula 3, European F3000. I had, more or less a year to the day before he died, I had supper with him at a lovely restaurant in Enna, Pagusa.
Yeah.
And just a lovely evening, just 3 or 4 of us sitting there. And which was the first time I really kind of got to know him well over, you know, it was a long dinner. And unfortunately, I was at Alton Park on the day of the accident as well. So, I mean, I had got to know him pretty well, and he was, as Derek said, very eloquent. He was driving the wrong car when he did European 3000, but then when he got with Magic in 91, just everything clicked, and he looked unbeatable.
Yes.
And he was against good people as well. Richard Dean, for example, very, very good driver, very high caliber driver.
Richard Westbrook.
Phil Andrews, and he was very experienced in 3000. Yeah. I mean, there were some good people in that championship, and Paul just looked unbeatable.
He was a bit like the Pied Piper, you know. Whoever he come in touch with would be his next biggest fan, because he had that kind of following, and I think it hurt a lot of people. I remember at the funeral, the vicar was very upset because I wanted tributes. He said, you know, we should put it towards some charity or something. I said, no, you know, we want to give him a big send-off. And when we come out of the church to go to the grave, there was tributes lined each side of the path for 200-300 yards. I mean, there was, I don't know, 500, 200, I don't know, but a lot from Senna, from Bernie, from all Formula One drivers. It was special. And after the after we buried him, we went back to the Swan, which my Uncle Stan owned, and had a few drinks, which was next to the church. And after a little while, I walked back to have a moment on my own with Paul, and the vicar was there. And I said, "Oh, you know, thank you very much. It was a great sermon." He said, "Derek," he said, "this has really changed my view." He said, "This was the most emotional." Here we go again.
Well, I think what we should do is we should have a look at your time when you arrived in Formula One, because it wasn't easy, I have to say. Your year at Tolman in 81. The list of results is not pretty reading, I have to say. And did not qualify.
I think the best thing that happened to that car was probably when Brian Henton hit the Silverstone chicane with it.
Demolished. I've got a picture of him stepping out the car with it just smouldering. And I thought that's the best thing for that car is to be in a big smouldering heap.
But the silver lining in that year was you did win a bet, didn't you? That you actually managed to get it on the grid, didn't you? Bet, was it £5,000 with someone that you'd actually finally, and you did the last race of the season
in Vegas.
You got it on the grid. So it wasn't all bad.
No, it wasn't all bad. I mean, the car. I mean, I always remember my. We talk about the proudest moments. You know, we talk about the World Championship in Superstocks. Obviously, winning Le Mans, but that first time you're a Grand Prix driver, it's pretty special. You know, you've worked so bloody hard to get there, and you know, and then you finally go out as a Grand Prix driver. And I remember that our first race was actually Imola, and I was stood in the pit lane, proud as punch, my chest puffed out, signing autographs. And I was in the middle of doing one autograph, and then all of a sudden somebody snatched the pen, because Villeneuve had walked about 500 yards away, so it put me back in my box, really. And but you know, in the early days, we were 14 seconds off the back of the grid. That's how bad the flying pig was, you know. And we gradually made it a little bit better, but the concept was poor. We didn't have enough money. We couldn't come out with a new car. And the Ross, you know, Ross, we all know about Rory Byrne, you know, one of the greatest designers of all time. So he just got it wrong, and we just didn't have enough money those first 2 years. So 81 and 82 with the flying pig was hard work, you know, and we missed qualifying as much as we qualified, to be honest.
We've got a question here, which we've got so many questions. I'm not going to be able to find specific ones when I actually think of them. But there is a question about Brian as a teammate and what he was like.
Funny enough, we had Agence de Pilotes in Ferrari about 4 or 5 weeks ago. So I was there with people like Teddy Pilette and Derek Bell and Vern Schuppen and Brian Henton. And me and Brian have always had a bit of an aggressive friendship, I suppose is the right way of doing it. What Brian taught me is how to survive in Formula One, because he was a tough bugger. Because he was a devious god, because he was all those things. I don't need to hide, because I said it. I repeated it all to him at Ferrari 4 weeks ago, and he sat there almost proud of how I was summing him up, because I was talking in front of all the other drivers. I said, but he taught me how to survive. He taught me that you can't just be Mr. Nice Guy. You can't just expect to turn up and everybody's just going to give you the best car and the best engine. You've got to survive. And it's to his peril, really, because, you know, I was with him in 1980 when he won the Formula 2 championship, and I was second. And then in Formula 1, you know, he was my teammate. But I survived for 82. He didn't. So he taught me. He was quick. Bloody quick, but like I say, he was devious, he was aggressive, and he taught me a lot in terms of being a complete racing driver, I think, you know, because I was a bit raw, you know. I ran my own car for 4 years, for goodness sake, and then joined Tolman. My Tolman in 80 Formula 2 was my first ever works drive, and then all of a sudden I'm in Formula 1, so I had a lot of learning to do, and he helped me do that.
Can I just rewind the clock to the beginning of the Tolman time, if I may? I mean, Brian became your teammate after Tolman dropped Stephen South, who was supposed to it was supposed to be you and Stephen in the team, and Stephen went to drive for McLaren without permission, and he got sacked. He always struck me as again, watching him in Formula Ford and Formula 3 and stuff, he looked like a really bright star of the future. Unfortunately, he was very badly injured in a Can-Am accident as his career ended. I just wonder what your recollections of Stephen are as a rival, I think
Stephen would have given me more problems than Brian. We all know Stephen was an unbelievable driver. Would he have made it in Formula 1? Absolutely. Was he quick enough for Formula 1? Absolutely. Was he quicker than Brian and me? I think we'd have given him a good run for the money, but he deserved to be in that Tolman car that year. He was a bit silly going off and driving the F1 without getting permission. And Alex Hawkridge, you know, it really it was something he should have done, and Alex had no option but to get rid of him. I think he'd have been a great champion, Stephen. You know, it was unfortunate with the accident with Can-Am, because that put paid to his racing career, of course.
Now, just before we move on to the move to Renault and sort of the rest of the F1 sports cars and things, I must mention that there's a special offer for all of you listening. And that's if you go to shop.mercedes-benz.com and you enter silver-10 in capital letters. I'll repeat that because I didn't actually even catch that myself. Silver-10 in capital letters. When you're at the checkout, you get 10% off all motorsport items. And I've I went in there this morning, and you can get a key ring of the Moss & Jenks 55 Mercedes-Benz SLR, 300 SLR. So it's very motorsport in there. And you also get a life-size sticker of Lewis Hamilton and Nico Rosberg. So there you go, Simon. You can have one of those on your wall. The offer does end on July 31st, so to make the most of it and get in there now. That's shop.mercedes-benz.com. So the move to Renault, it must have been like night and day going from Tolman to Renault, wasn't it?
Was also night and day going from 82 to 83. The 83 car was a proper racing car. You know, you could feel it, you understood what was going on. Of course, it kept breaking down, and we were the only driver, I think, in the last four Grand Prix to finish in the points. So we had our first points ever for Tolman in Zandvoort that year in 83. So then things really turned around for me as a driver. A lot of other people were talking about me, and obviously we started speaking to Renault to LaRousse for the 84 season, and I always remember, because we sort of negotiated, we knew where we were going to be, and I'd already spoken to Tolman and to Alex Hawkridge, and we were at the racing car show at the end of 83, and my father rang me and said, are you sat down, boy? And I'm thinking, oh no, it's turned to crap, you know? And I said, come on, Dad, just tell me, what is it? And he said, I've just had a telex through confirming your drive from LaRousse. And he told me what the number was, how much it was and everything. And we got very drunk that night. all of a sudden, I'm driving for a works team. You know, I'm driving for Renault, you know, one of the greatest teams in Formula One at that stage, I thought. And, it was, at that time, I knew it was going to be Patrick Tambay was the other driver. I always say the second driver. He doesn't really like that, but the second driver. And 84 was just fantastic. The car was just amazing. Again, you know, we had too many failures. Grand Prix driver today, I have no idea what it was like to drive back in the 80s. You know, you broke down in more races than you finished, you know. So it was a difficult time. We almost won first time out in Brazil. We were normally quicker than Patrick. And then the crunch came at the British Grand Prix 84. And it was a great race at Brands Hatch. I ended up finishing
32-year anniversary this Friday.
I finished second. But LaRousse had put a lot of pressure on me to re-sign for the 85 season. I was already well in talks with Frank Williams to join Williams in 85. I had a little bit of a conversation with Ferrari, because remember, we didn't have managers in them days, so it was down to me. But I spoke to the Terrible Three, which was Alan Henry, Nigel Roebuck, and Morris Hamilton, who were my chief advisors. And between us, we quite rightly said the decision was to stay with Renault for 85. And of course, it was a disaster, because we lost LaRousse, we lost Michel Tetu, our chief designer, we lost Mijo, our aerodynamicist, and about three or four other engineers, lost them all. So the 85 car came out. We took it to Brazil beginning of 85, and it was 3.5 seconds slower than the 84 car. And of course, 85 is history, as they say. You know, it was a dreadful car. It was a dangerous car. And then my career really took a bit of a dip, I suppose.
But where one door closes, I suppose, and another one opens, and that's when you got into sports cars and you had so much success in those. Do you look back on it and think, well, actually, while it was a sort of a decision in hindsight, wasn't a great one, it did open that door for into sports cars?
Look, I look back in my career, and could I have won Grand Prix? Yes. Could I have been world champion? Yes. If I didn't have that self-belief, there's no point being a driver in the first place. Do I regret not signing for Williams? No. You know, do I regret all these things? No. I had a fantastic career. I drove some fantastic cars, and I'm here. I did not break a finger in arguably some of the most dangerous times in Formula One. So what have I got to be sad about, you know? I was disappointed at the end of 85 when Senna ended up getting rid of my contract with Lotus, because I'd love to have been teammates with Ayrton. Obviously, he didn't want me to be teammates with him, so that's a backhanded compliment in some ways.
He sent you a Christmas card, though, didn't he?
He sent me a Christmas card and a New Year's card wishing me all the best for 86. Now, remember, 86, I didn't have anything. You know? So I seriously believe that he just thought I would pick up another drive, you know, and he didn't think he was finishing my career. I think he just thought that Lotus couldn't produce two number one cars, and he didn't want this Brit that he thought was maybe a threat on the other side of the garage.
How did you get to find out about the thing?
Well, I'd signed my contract, and I was called back up to Lotus Christmas 85, all bullshy, thinking they're going to sign and obviously give me the signing on fee, if you like, just to be told that they've changed their mind, they're not signing me, they've torn my contract up. And obviously I asked for an explanation. They said Ayrton don't want you in the team. You know, the sponsorship is all around Ayrton. The sponsors have backed him, and we've decided to go a different way. And I said, well, hang on a minute, you know, all the drives are gone. You know, I've got nowhere to go. But, you know, Ayrton, quite rightly, they followed him because he, at that time, looked something special. And obviously, history has proved that he was more than something special.
We haven't got too long left, so I must rattle through some of these questions.
Okay.
But there's quite a nice one here about, you know, what we were just talking about, from Stephen, who says, Eau Rouge in a mid-80s turbo car in qualifying, or Mulsanne Kink in a Jaguar before the chicanes were installed?
Frightening.
Yeah, both of them, I think. I think both of them would be. I think he's wondering which you prefer. I think I prefer to watch.
I get disappointed when I hear modern-day guys talk about Eau Rouge, because it's almost a straight now. It's not even a lift for these guys. For us, I mean, as you went down the hill after turn one, you had to grab hold of your what's-its in tight, and you would just pray that you come out the other side. It was pretty special. The Mulsanne Kink, you know, we were approaching that at 400 kilometres an hour in a car that was very, very floaty, very, very. You had to drive your Le Mans car with almost kid gloves, with fingertips. You know, it was very, 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 very difficult.
And you had Porsche 911s and slow WMs and things floating around the side of you as well.
But you see, this is where stock cars maybe come out, because you know, I was used to overtaking cars and being overtaken and have them on the right side and the left side and all that sort of stuff. I enjoyed it. I love Le Mans. You give me it every day. I mean, I do three stints in the night because, you know, nobody else wanted to. You know, if it was raining and it was dark, you know, put Warwick in for three stints, you know.
Go and have a cup of tea.
I love my time at sports cars, you know, because unlike Formula One, I always had the best car, or one of the best cars. So, you know, I won races straight away. 86 with Jaguar, 91 with Jaguar, 92 world champion in Le Mans with Peugeot. And it kind of reconfirms that in the right car you can win, and I know this is going to come across awkward for some people. Winning is easy. When you qualify 26th and you work your ass off and finish 7th, the drive of your life, and I can name one when I was with Arrows at Suzuka. and you get back to the pits and they've already gone to the airport. And, you know, you've had the drive of your life and nobody knows about it. You know, it's they're the days that you've got to pick yourself up on the Monday morning and convince yourself to go back and do it again.
Was it, just one thing, was it at Jerez in 86 when...
Talk about Jerez in 86.
Yeah, that is the correct race I'm thinking of.
That's a yes then.
Yeah, I can't remember if there were two or three Silk Cut Jaguars that ended up in the gravel at three, yeah. And what was Tom Walkinshaw like that afternoon?
I'd like first of all say I was on pole. It wasn't my fault.
I didn't say it was your fault. Wanted to know what Tom Walkinshaw said.
But I'm saying that with a silly grin on my face. Tom was not happy. He was he was like a mini Bernie Eccleston. You know, he was frightening.
He was wider than Bernie Eccleston.
He was wider. He was bigger, fatter, not worth as much money. But he was. He was a good taskmaster. He really was, and he was good to drive. Me and him clashed a little bit. He was a massive Martin Brundle fan, so we always clashed. He wasn't happy that day. No.
Am I right in thinking that he signed at least two of you, and in your contract you had number one driver it was only when you started bragging to each other that you soon discovered that things weren't quite as they might have seemed.
86, I signed as number one driver, and we were going to St Moritz to do cross-country skiing. Eddie Cheever had already signed, Jean-Louis Schlescher and Brancatelli. And I'm last there, and we're all in a big, a dorm, the four drivers, and I arrived last. So I've obviously got the worst bed, you know. But what they'd done is they put my bed in a loft. There was a little door, and they somehow squeezed my bed in through this loft, and they said, oh, your room's in through there. And of course, that was funny. and then we all went down for a sauna, and we were sat in the sauna. And of course, the one thing Brian Henton taught me was, first of all, get into your teammate's head. Right, you know, if you can beat him here, it's easy to beat him on the track. So I'd sat in there and I said, you know, Eddie, I'm really surprised that you signed as my number two. Excuse me? I said, I'm really surprised you. He said, I've signed as number one. I said, no, I signed as number one. I've signed as number one. So obviously we both had this number one contract. So he rushed out the door because I was already in his head. And I was comfortable because I could imagine what Walkinshaw was up to. But they were good days, good days.
But then you mentioned Bernie then as well. There was when you signed for him, I think you sort of got a little bit of a taste of his negotiating skills when you signed at the dotted line.
Well, I think the sad thing about motor racing is when we lost Elio, it was a big hit for all of us because he was such a gorgeous guy, he really was. And when I heard about the accident, I understand from Bernie afterwards, he had something like 8 phone calls within an hour of the accident saying that they were ready to drive for him. I didn't do that because I didn't think it was right. And I left it about a week, and then Bernie contacted me. And I think he appreciated the fact that I hadn't called him. And he said, you know, it's Bernie here. Would you like to come and talk about driving for me? So, yeah, of course. So we made a date, and I got on a plane. By the time I got to Brabham, I convinced myself that I was worth $20 million. You know, I mean, you know, dead man's seat. You know, it was a big job. The car's crap. And I've really got to bring the team together. So I got into the room. I said, look, Bernie, I said, before we talk contract, I want to go and look at the cars and speak to the guys. No. I said, well, you know, I'd like to know what I'm getting into. No, we do the contract first. Oh, okay, then, right. I said, so then he said, he showed me the contract, and I said, oh, Bernie, I said, you know, this is just not going to happen. I said, because, you know, dead man's shoes, you know, the team's in a bit of a hole at the moment, the car's shit, et cetera, et cetera. And I always remember he said, this is the contract. Sign it or go home. And to be fair to him, it was Elio's contract less 7 races or whatever it was. And so I understood that straight away. Then took me round, and we got to the race shop, and all the mechanics were working on the cars, and they're all going thumbs up. They wanted me to be a part of the team, so I gave them the thumbs up. And all of a sudden, they all disappeared back in the cars, and I thought, oh, what's wrong? And I looked round. Bernie was red in the face, and there was a phone in the workshop with, you know, just bolted on the wall with a receiver, obviously, that gets on the top. Imagine this was 86, not too modern. And somebody had put the receiver back on and twisted the wire. he ripped the phone off the wall and threw it on the floor because somebody had twisted the wire and it wasn't inch perfect.
Wasn't immaculate.
You know, if you go into the drawing office, all the blinds were at 45 degrees and the chain taken off so they couldn't change it. Everything with Bernie has been proper. But, you know, he's made Formula One what it is.
He's done okay, hasn't he?
He's done okay. And he's done okay for us as well. He's made a lot of us a lot of money. And he's made Formula One, you know, one of the great sports in the world.
When you look back at pictures of the low-line Brabham and you see how far you're sticking out the top of it, didn't that occur to you at the time?
But you know what? Yeah, of course it occurred to me at the time. But that era was safer than the previous era. So you always thought you were in the height of technology. I mean, that car was awesome. At Monza, we had almost 1,500 horsepower. We went up 2,000 revs on every gear ratio, and we were on the limiter at 230 mile an hour just as we passed the pit exit. It was like a time bomb. It was brilliant, absolutely fantastic.
And how was it working with Gordon Murray? Because I don't know whether he was. Did you say that he was away with way the fairies or something?
I think it was disappointing. I think he had already found other things to do. The reason I signed is I thought, although I knew the car was pretty awful, you know, we all hear about Gordon Murray and the Midas touch, that he'd bring a set of springs or a roll bar and transform the car, but didn't. The car was rubbish at the start and it was rubbish at the end. You know, the chassis was flexing because of this low down car. It wasn't strong enough, other than the engine, it didn't really have many good points. So Gordon was a little bit disappointing for me, but I think I caught him in sort of an intermediate year, and he wasn't at his best.
So I'm just shifting through some questions here. That was the one from Curtis, that one, by the way, about Gordon Murray. There's one here that I can't say I've ever heard about, but it's Matt in Shout, Korea. I'm thinking South Korea. I'd like to hear about the accident at a charity kart race that caused you to miss the 89 French Grand Prix. The television commentators reported that your engine seized and you crashed into a transit van. What happened there?
I was invited to the Bully Bay, because I've lived in Jersey now for 32 years. I was invited to open the hill up in a cart, but in typical Derek Warwick fashion, he made sure the cart had the best engine. We had brand new tyres, the softest tyres you could run on the hill, because I thought, you know, I'm going to do more than just a demonstration. After the first two runs, I was 2/10 quicker than everybody. So it turned into a demonstration, into a full run. And as I, because it was a 100cc, so it wasn't a grid start, it was a rolling start, so they pushed you and off you went. And as I went over the start-finish line, I got all the carburetor and leaned it off just to make it go a bit quicker. The blasted thing seized as I went over the line, and little did I know, is me, Mr. Safety, there was an ambulance parked on the entrance to a car park, basically blocking you going into the car park, and of course nothing in front of it, and the thing seized. I took it sideways and went underneath the back of this ambulance, and broke my back. So I got carted off to hospital, got fined $25,000 from Jackie Oliver for doing the kart race without permission. And of course that was where Martin Donnelly got his break, and he drove my car at the French Grand Prix. So yeah, the only time I injured myself in a race car, really.
Amazing. We've got lots of questions here about the XJR14. I remember you talking about it briefly last time, and how when you first got into it, it was flat through the final corner, I think, and the whole team ducked behind the pits. But everyone's basically wondering what it was like to drive and just how physical it was. And
there is no way that was a sports car. I mean, it was a Formula One car. It was just unbelievable. Ross Brawn, obviously, designed car, a beautiful car. It was just a rocket car. It really was. And when we tested the car, it was on the old South Circuit at Silverstone. And as you go where the new wing is now, there was a fast right-hand corner going into a chicane. And everything I've ever driven there, because I shook down a lot of Formula One cars there, that right was not flat in anything. I went through the corner on the installation lap, came into the pits, and I just could not stop smiling. And Ross said, what are you smiling at? I said, Ross, this is unbelievable. He said, you've only done a lap, one lap, installation lap. What's the matter with you? And the next lap, I knew I could take that right-hander flat, and I took it flat, and I remember looking out the side door as I was taking it flat. That's how easy it was, flat. And everybody was ducked underneath the Armco because they thought the throttles were stuck open. And it was just one of those moments, you know, and the car was brilliant. It was difficult getting out of a window because that was the door. It was a little window. But, yeah, it was the best car, best sports car I've ever driven, the fastest sports car I've ever driven. It was just tremendous. And we'd have been world champion that year, but we lost the win at Silverstone, and that cost me the championship.
We've got another car-related question here, actually. This is from Roger. It's a question and a statement. Every time I see that Lotus Lamborghini, I think those two had a cast iron set of balls to drive that thing. I think I'm allowed to say that. Well, I've said it now. How was the car to drive? Because I actually was, with this comment came a YouTube video of some onboard footage with you.
From Hockenheim.
And yes, from Hockenheim. And it was physical stuff. Because the camera's attached to the car, it's your body that's moving so much, and your legs are absolutely crammed in, yet they're still, you know, I don't know how.
It just didn't fit me. You know, as you can see, I'm quite a broad guy, and I remember my shoulders used to overlap the side of the tub. The car was dangerous, you know, it almost killed Martin Donnelly. It should have killed me at Monza. And the car was weak, you know, it was every time we had an accident, it broke in half. It was just a poor car. But that Lamborghini was just the most amazing sounding engine. I'll tell you how bad it was. Is on the press launch, which is up at Lotus, we had a marquee just outside the workshop where all the press was. And I was supposed to drive it from the workshop into the marquee, obviously revving this lovely V12 up. As I came out of the workshop, the gearbox snapped off the back of the engine. So that wasn't a good start, really. So we pushed it back, got some angle clamps, clamped the gearbox back in. Obviously, we didn't have no drive then. So then the mechanics opened the tent and pushed me in with me blipping the throttle. So I should have realized then that things were not going to be good. But, I think I remember Lord March saying to me one year, Derek, he said, I've got just the car for you. I said, what's that? He said, I've got your Lotus from 1990 to drive at Goodwood. I said, Lord March, that thing tried to kill me three times in 1990. I am not going to give it another chance. it was a shame. You know, normally the question comes from the floor saying, what was your best racing car? And I'd rather say, I've driven a lot of shit boxes. And I'd like to put them in order, but that Lotus was definitely one of them.
We've got literally a few minutes left. We've got a couple of questions here about tracks. Anthony Jenkins is asking, which old track would you like to return to the to F1 now, and which is your, and then another one from Marco here, which is your favourite circuit. So sort of a two-part question. If you're equipped with your XJR14,
I really like the old Silverstone, you know, when you had the flat stow, flat club, and bridge corner. I really like that. I think, you know, if I could go back to that, it'd be great. Favorite circuit, Monaco. You know, I mean, just, you know, you had to have all your senses had to be 100% at Monaco. And I remember when I put the arrows, the 89 arrows, six on the grid on the third row, even Berger, if you remember, he had the accident at Imola that year, so he didn't race at Monaco, and he came up to me after qualifying when I qualified six, and he came up to me and he had all burnt hands, and he put his hand in mine and he said, gentle please, and I shook his hand and he said, you're nuts, he said, you're mad, he said, you are the most impressive driver out there. And for another driver to say that, it's pretty cool. But the question was, Silverstone, I'd like to turn that back to where it was. I love Suzuka, but Monaco is my favorite, just because, you know, you really had to earn your money at Monaco. When you got out of Monaco, when you had the gear shift, your hands bled, your feet bled, you know, it was a tough job, especially one lap qualifiers, ground effect, one lap, and 1500 horsepower. I mean, they were brutes. It was like I say, I'm the luckiest person in the world. You know, to have come through the 80s and early 90s where we had paddle shift and active ride suspension, and so I had a little bit of everything. I had the danger. You know, you were thought of as gladiators. They were tough cars to drive, and you survived that era, which was pretty remarkable, really.
Although Monaco has the lowest average speed of the F1 season, from trackside it looks by far the fastest circuit, just because of proximity. I'm sure it must feel exactly the same way inside the car.
I remember walking through the tunnel once on my way from Mirabeau to the pits, and it's when we had pre-qualifying. And I stood in the middle of the tunnel. I thought I'd watch the first few cars come through. And Stefan Johansson came through in an Onyx. Sparks flying, bottom out, and the sort of the wind effect as it came through the tunnel. I thought, shit. I mean, honestly, it was frightening. I mean, I thought, this is ridiculous. And I remember I went out the tunnel thinking, no, I don't really like that. And of course, half an hour later, you're strapped to the same thing going through. And it was quite nice going through there in the car, but watching was just frightening. It really was.
Just to finish off, what I'd love to do is sort of bring it up to date. And we've talked about some of the work you're doing with young drivers at the moment. I'm right in thinking you helped Oliver Rowland quite a lot. How's he getting on at the moment?
Fantastic. I've been mentoring. This is my fourth year with Oliver. First saw him at the McLaren or Swap BLC Young Driver of the Year. He was that guy I was talking about at Stowe on the first lap, and I thought, who is that? And it was Oliver Rowland, you know. And he throws a few curveballs at me now and again.
Say, you were more or less his parole officer for a while, weren't
yes,
you?
Yes, it was. He's been different, shall I say? But I think he has enormous talent. He should be in Formula One. He obviously he broke every record in Renault 3.5 last year. More wins, more points, more rostrums, more fastest laps, etc., etc. Absolutely stunning. He's in a car now at the moment that I would say is probably the fifth best team. He's leading the championship, you know, in GP2. So he is pretty special. But, you know, I think as president of the British Racing Drivers Club, everybody keeps on saying, what's your legacy? What's your legacy? I haven't really got a legacy. I haven't really thought about it. But I'd like to think that I've pushed our young driver programs on. You know, this year we've got 12 superstars, you know, Alex Lynn, Oliver Rowland, Barnacote, Jake Dennis, Will Palmer, all these guys are just fantastic drivers. We've got a great group of young British drivers at the moment, and I really enjoy that, and I really enjoy being chairman of the McLaren Autosport BIDC Young Driver of the Year, and that's really what the BIDC is about. You know, we're 850 members, we're a racing drivers club, that's what we should be supporting. We should be supporting the new Lewis Hamilton, Jenson Button, because when they go, there's a big hole at the moment. You know, Jolyon might make it, we don't know, it's early days for him, but we've got some drivers that I think, people like George Russell, you know, they should be in, they should be knocking on the door of Formula One.
But I mean, how frustrating do you find it that it is so money driven at the moment? I mean, you look at me, a guy like Lance Stroll, very good driver, but he's never had to fight as hard as some of the European drivers have had to fight, because he's always had...
I've got issue with that, because I think that, yeah, he can't, his father's a billionaire or whatever, he's still got to do it.
Mm. Oh, and he is doing it.
You know, he's bloody fast, he's winning races, he's leading the championship. So I think, you know, if he's got an opportunity to go all the way, which it seems he have, bloody good luck to him. Mm. What is frustrating is when you see great British talent that we've got at the moment, and there's not enough support within the UK system, whether it's government, whether it's lottery funding, whether it's private individuals, we haven't got enough support to get these guys all the way to Formula One, and that's frustrating for me.
That's what I'm because if it came to a team having to choose between Lance Stroll, say, and Ben Barnacote or Oliver Rowland, you know,
absolutely,
99% for certain that they're going to go for the guy yes. who's got good backing behind him.
Well, their only hope is when you get a change of the guard. You know, the people at the moment seem to be following older, more experienced drivers. But I think people like Verstappen is starting to change that attitude a little bit, and people are more open to risk. But as we well know, it's also about money. You know, half the grid now, you know, the two Sauber drivers are bringing 10 and 12 million or something, you know. So it's very difficult to know how you get a young driver into Formula One now.
Well, on that note, Derek, thank you so much for joining us. It's been an absolutely fantastic hour in the beautiful sunshine here. Alan, thank you so much for doing all the audio. Simon, thank you for joining us as well. We'll be back next month for another Motorsport Magazine podcast.
Can I just say it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.